chapter to you. Give them deeper revelation of who you are, oh God. Help them to respond to the word. Let the word that was preached this morning, let it, Lord God, become a seed that is watered, God. Let that seed bear forth and break out, Lord God, and bring life into the spirit of those that received it, God. Lord, help us all to draw deeper, Lord, in holiness. Help us all, God, to draw closer to you. That's what holiness is. Help us, God, to draw closer to you, Lord. Help us to be transformed, God, into your image, Lord, so that we can be used by you in Jesus' mighty name. Hallelujah. God, I'm asking you, Lord, to give us a greater amount, Lord Jesus, of revelation, a greater amount of understanding, a deeper depth, God, of wisdom, Lord. I'm asking you, Lord, to help us, God, to have the strength to continue fighting. Help us to have the strength we need this week, God, whenever the touch the future wears off, God, whenever the conference wears off. Help us, Lord, to get our renewing in prayer. Help us, God, to go to the Word of God and get renewed, Jesus. Help us, God, to get back up whenever we stumble. Help us, God, to keep pressing, Lord, and keep pushing, Jesus, for all that you have for us, God. Help us, Lord, to be warriors, Jesus, more than overcomers, champions in the spirit, God. When the devil comes with his lies and his accusations against us, help us, God, to resist him and submit to you that he will flee. Help us, God, to speak life when the devil speaks doubt. When the devil speaks death, help us, God, to speak of faith. Help us, Lord God, to continue pressing, pressing, God, pressing persistently, day after day after day, as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. Help us, God, to endure the hardships of life, God. Help us, God, to pay the bills in faith. Help us to go to work in faith. Help us, God, to await your return, which is soon and very soon, God. Help us, Lord, to occupy until you come. But help us to do it all in faith, God, looking unto you in Jesus' mighty name. God, wherever we go, wherever we step foot, God, I pray that you give us the blessings of Joshua, that wherever we go, Lord, you would give to us. Help us who bear the name of Jesus to proclaim the name of Jesus, not just in word, but in deed, in how we act, in what we say, in what we do. Help us, God, to often wipe, Lord Jesus, clean the thoughts of our mind and resubmit ourselves to you throughout the day, God. In Jesus' mighty name, I worship you. I worship you, Jesus, and I magnify you, God. Oh, I thank you, Lord, for your presence that is in this house. I thank you, Lord, for the Holy Ghost that we feel right now, your Spirit, Jesus. God, I'm praying that you would help us, Jesus, to respond to whatever you ask of us this night. Help us, God, to choose you. Help us not to choose our way, but help us, God, to choose your way, because your ways are higher, your ways are better, oh God. I magnify your name, Jesus, because you are good. Not because of blessing, and yes, you bless us, God, but because you are good. I thank you, Lord, that we can gather this Sunday night in the house of God without being persecuted by our government, without being told what we can and cannot do. And when the day does come, help us to be strong. Help us, Lord, to press. And as the singers come to the stage, I wonder if we could all just not worry about tomorrow, not worry about Monday's issues and problems, but if we could just give our hearts to the Lord right now, let's just give God everything that we have and worship him in Jesus' name.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Amen. It's good to see you in the house of God. And then why don't we continue to worship Jesus and to magnify Jesus for everything that he's done in our hearts and our minds and our spirits.
Say, come, now is the time to worship. steadfast, you are God. When the agony will bow still, still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you now. One day every tongue will confess you are God. One day every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you now. Lord, come. Now is the time to worship. Come. Now is the time to give your heart. Come. Just as you are.
To come into, Lord God, your courts with praise for allowing us to worship and to magnify you forever. In Jesus' name.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Well, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
It's good to be in the house of God tonight.
Amen.
Well, we had a conference this weekend, and so we're going to start off with people who went to that conference, and we're going to ask them that they testify about what God did for them or what God did in others' lives that they witnessed. And while they were at the conference, for the edification of those who aren't able to go. So any of those people who went to that conference first, who have a mic, who would like to go? Praise the Lord. Well, I'll go first. Hallelujah. Amen. God did a mighty work in my life, definitely. It was a fantastic conference. They had Brother Wayne Huntley there, who's a powerful man of God. They had Brother Kleindienst there, who's a powerful man of God, an evangelist. Amen. And then they also had Brother Daniel Autry there, who's a powerful man of God. Brother Joey Campitello, who's a powerful man of God. And they ministered to all of us. And I especially enjoyed the last day, Saturday, with Brother Autry, and with Brother Joey. Yes, Brother Joey. And that touched my spirit. It invigorated us. It invigorated me. It challenged us to continue pressing on to remember the thesis of the Great Commission. And I thank Jesus for that. Praise the Lord. Is there anybody else? Amen. Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Hello.
Just by the way, everybody on this stage except for Sister Madonna went, so they got to go next. Somebody, all right, figure it out. It was an incredible conference. You know, I say every year, out of all the conferences, if I had to choose one, as much as I love all of them, Touch the Future is the one that I would always go to, because that church doesn't just put on a conference; they fast and they pray and they prepare like no other. And when you step foot into their building, you feel the thick presence of the Holy Ghost everywhere in that place. And, you know, it's not from this year, but the first year I went 6 years ago and stepped foot into their prayer room, it was like a blanket of the Holy Ghost just rushed over me as soon as I opened the door. It's incredible. And, you know, we have the power to have that here too, but we have to be diligent to pray and to fast like their church does. Because it doesn't just happen from the leaders, it's from the whole church doing it together. And we will get there one day as long as we continue to work in unity. Amen. But to say from this year, sorry, not trying to sneak a preach, as Pastor Jason said at the conference, every service was absolutely incredible. And God spoke to me about different things in every single service. And of course, you go and you write it down and, okay, I can't wait to apply this or change that. You know, Brother Huntley, in the first service, the opening service, talked about openness, being open. And not just being open to the things of God, but being open to miracles and signs and wonders. To not ask God, why? How can this be? We're not supposed to ask, how can this be? We're supposed to trust him, right? We ask that because we're fleshly. But if we ask that, we're not allowing those things to happen. So we have to quit asking, how can this be, and say, Jesus, do it.
Amen.
Open up and say, Jesus, do it, so that we can see it and we can receive it. And of course, the last message that touched me tremendously was Brother Autry's message. And it was Wonders in the Deep, was the title. And the bottom line to that message was reaching the lost. You know, the conference was called Remember the Mission this year. And the main mission as Christians is to reach the lost.
Amen.
That's our main mission. And, you know, he spoke things. Before he was a pastor, he was a dynamic, incredible, one of the best children's leaders that we have in UPCI. And he was talking about kids' things, too, as he was preaching. And he said, take your cute kids and go to the park and witness to somebody. You know, he said little things like that, and it reminded me of the works that me and my husband have done with park ministries. And even now, we go to the park and we minister and we pray for people and we give out church cards. It just told me that I was doing what God wanted me to do. It was an affirmation. Even though I know, of course, I know, because I love it and I'm passionate about it, I know it's what I'm called to. But it was just another affirmation that I'm doing right and I'm stepping forward into a new dimension of children's ministry and reaching lost children and their families for God. It was just beautiful. And the unity and the prayer, I could go on and on forever about all the great things that happened. It was powerful and impactful and forever changed my life with many different things. Amen.
Amen. And she's not over exaggerating. It was like that for everyone that I saw that went from our church, those who went with our church. It impacted each of their lives, especially that last day when Brother Autry preached about Wonders of the Deep and when Brother Joey preached about Behold, He Cometh. It was a powerful conference, and all the services are online for those who weren't able to go, who want to watch. Praise the Lord. Is there anyone else who attended who would like to go?
Let's see, where do I start, guys? All right, so I'm going to be speaking from the point of view of me and my boy Joe, because we both went together. And let's just start off like this. Car ride over there, you know, having a good time, talking about the Word of God and all that. Just already getting ourselves hyped up, you know, just for when we show up. First thing I do, you know, I go over. I'm nervous because it's a brand new church. I don't know anything. I don't know anyone. I know but I've never been to Souls Harbor. So I'm already scared. I'm walking around and seeing people all over the place. And they start showing me the building. And the first place I go to is that, you know, that same prayer room. And I go in there, man, and it's just crazy, bro. Immediately they're just praying and they're yelling and they're going out of their way to, you know, pray for others and everything. And it was just great. So that right there is part one of it. So then, you know, everybody comes out. Alright guys, it's time. Everybody go into the sanctuary. So we go over there, and just like everybody in here said, you know, that boy Autry, bro, he don't play. He's literally like, no, bro, you gotta get your hands dirty. Simple as that. You gotta get your hands dirty. And he's like, so what I loved about it, and he reminded me of Pastor Dagan and how he was so unapologetic about it. He was like, no, dude, I'm sorry. You have to get your hands dirty. no matter what you do, whether it's going to the park, whether it's ministering here, whether it's ministering to that drug addict or that abusive husband, you know, that like that. I mean, you gotta get your hands dirty regardless of anything. So that right there is what touched me the most. I kept thinking about that. As some of you saw, I was praying in here for 3 minutes, and the whole time I'm freaking out because I don't know how to pray. I'm not a really big fan of praying, but okay. So, you know, then on top of that, you know, I just kept thinking. You know, I was like, what should I do? What should I do? And then, you know, that message came in. You gotta get your hands dirty. You can't just let, you know, the devil just take advantage of you right then and there just because you're doing something you're not too comfortable with doing. I mean, I'm up here singing, and if I can sing, I can definitely pray. So, you know what I mean? So I'm definitely gonna do that. So that was really good, man. I really enjoyed it. And then Joey Campitella just added to it, man. And just him, like, for those of you who were there, well, for those of you who weren't there, just him saying, "Behold, he cometh," he started shaking. Like, he's literally like this. And he's like, "Behold, cometh." And then he goes, moving, and the Spirit of God is already just right in there, in that place, from the get-go. So when I left, again, I hate saying this because this is how I felt. When I left, I was happy and I was Holy Ghost filled, but there was a part of me that was angry. And the fact that I was mad is because, why didn't I do this sooner? Why didn't I go sooner? I wish, but going over there on Saturday and really taking it all in, and the services and people being there and people praying over me and I'm praying over people, and then the worship and just everything all together, you know, it just gave me a big reminder that, you know, there's great things ahead in the ministry of God and in my life personally. So I'm definitely looking forward to not missing out anymore. I'm definitely looking forward to being more active and being more, you know, pulling up to church more often, pulling up to conferences more often. Even if it's something as simple as a VBS workday, I can still show up and, you know, just do it, because it's not for me and it's not for anybody else, but it's for God. So.
Amen.
That's from my point of view. So, yeah.
Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord, everybody. Why don't you worship with us?
We have heard the thunder. We have seen the storms, echoes of your kingdom coming,
and rumors
of our home,
where one day
we'll stand before you, Lord.
Lord, all together,
beautiful reward,
and we will give you glory.
Where one day we'll stand before you, Lord.
altogether beautiful
reward.
And we will give you glory,
bring you honor, King above all kings. You deserve our everything. We will lift our voices with your praises. Jesus, you are
Jesus, you're our King God. We give you all the glory, Lord Jesus. Oh, hallelujah, 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 Jesus. Oh, yes, thank you, Lord Jesus. Brother Zach. Anybody else like to testify before we sing our last song from conference today? Sister Sherry.
Okay, I will go.
All right, Sister Miss Sunny. Okay.
This was my first time going. It won't be my last.
Amen.
It was electrifying from start to finish. And as Sister Jackie said, the main theme was remember the mission. But a sub-theme, if you would, for me was where is the treasure of your heart? Because if the treasure of your heart and your mind's in the right place and Jesus and saving souls, then you'll remember the mission. You'll be able to go out there and seek and save that which was lost, though. I was glad to be a part, and I'll go next year, next year.
Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord, Brother Joseph.
Well, praise the Lord. I suppose I ought to testify. Wow. All I can say is wow. When I got there, the first place Brother Louis took me was to the prayer room. I'm going to tell you what, there are years of prayer in that building.
That's right.
Because you walk in there and there is no resistance. It's just Holy Ghost. It's 0 to 100 just like that. As far as you want to go, you can get there immediately. I was excited. That's one of the main reasons I want to go back for that prayer room.
Yeah,
hallelujah. But Brother Autry preached a message, as she said, Wonders of the Deep. And that message changed my perspective. It changed my mind, changed my spirit, and it redirected me. And he talked about using the dirty rags, the nasty old rotten rags, to use them to save somebody that's in a pit. And I'm going to tell you what, it revealed to me there is no excuse. There is nothing that can stop us, stop me from winning souls. Hallelujah. If I got my Bible and some shoes on my feet, I can go spread the gospel. I'm going to tell you what, and that's exactly what I plan to do in Jesus' name. Thank you all very much.
together wonderful to me. Light of the world, you step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see. Beauty that made this heart adore you. Hope of a life spent with you. And here I am to worship. Here I am.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Can we continue
Hallelujah,
to clap our
Jesus.
Hands unto the Lord?
Pastor, I'm sorry. I know this is kind of a little out of line, but may I share one more thing from conference, please, when we came home? So as we were saying, conference was impactful, and also in that message by Daniel Autry, he said to be bold as a Christian. Everyone, that, they emphasize that. As a Christian, we are to be bold to reach the lost. Because if we're not bold, then we're not going to get past the fear and the anxiety to go out into the deeper things where we don't know what's there or how it's going to look. Sometimes reaching people is messy and it's confusing and you don't know if you're doing the right thing. And so you have to trust in God and you have to be bold. And he said, don't be afraid to share the word with other people. Some people will accept it and some people won't. But be thankful that the people who accepted it are now learning and then they're on their way to being saved, and that's another one for the kingdom. With saying all of that, when I got home that exact night, I received a message on Messenger, and it was just hi. And it was actually from an old friend of my husband back when they were in middle school and high school. We were very close when my husband and I first got together with his friend Jay. He was in the military for a couple years. We went and saw his graduation and everything. We were very close. But then when my husband and I got into the church, we lost contact because he lived in the world very much so and wanted nothing to do with church. But he contacted me, and I thought, well, you know, it's probably a scam, because you know how you get scam messages like that through Messenger sometimes. But I went ahead and wrote back nicely, you know, hi, oh my gosh, long time no here, you know, how are you doing? He said, well, I just really need someone to talk to. Everybody that's around me won't speak to me. My wife left me. He drinks every night. He had to sell his car to pay his bills at home. And we're going through this whole dialogue back and forth, you know, texting. And he starts to tell me that, you know, he hates his life and all these things. And I told him, I said, listen, I know you're not into church and all that, and I would never push anything on you, but God is the only thing that saved me and Louis. Our relationship would not be, we would not be together. We would not be serving in the church together and have a beautiful family if it wasn't for God. That's the only thing that's going to help you, my friend. We're here for you, but that's the only thing. And he, oh, I don't want to hear that. I just need someone to talk to. You know, I shouldn't have messaged you. It was a mistake. I want to unlive my life, he says. I'm sorry I messaged you. Goodbye. And the Holy Ghost immediately said, be bold. I texted him and I said, Jay, you did not message me by mistake. God gave you the whatever to message me. You know, he told you to do it. And you didn't realize that it was God. It's a God thing that you messaged me. Because you messaged me and you poured out your heart, God is reaching for you. Brother, I'm going to pray for you. Reach out to us. We will continue to speak with you and help you through whatever we can. I'm not telling you to go to church. I'm telling you to accept God and his word. That's what you need to do first. But I'm praying for you, and we love you. And that was it. He said, okay, thanks. And that was it. It was a seed. It was a nugget. Because I was bold and I didn't let the enemy say, well, he doesn't want to hear what you have to say. I listened to God when he said, be bold. The night I came home from conference, and similar thing happened to my mother. God is moving on us if we listen to be bold and to reach the people. Amen. Amen, amen.
Let's just worship God for a minute. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, I worship you. God, I magnify you. Bless your name, Jesus. Yes, God. Thank you, Lord, for choosing us, God, in this final day, in this final hour, God, to bear your name, to be ambassadors for you, Jesus. I worship you, God. I thank you, Lord. Help us, God, to be bold. Help us, Lord Jesus, to reach, God, the world in this day and in this age. Help us not to be afraid, God, but to go forth in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. We might as well stay in that vein right now. Let's go ahead and begin prayer. We're going to pray over Sister Katrina. She needs a touch in her body. God can heal her. We're going to also mention Miranda Ratliff and her family, Mary Ann, and we're going to be praying over the Bible studies that are fixed and begin that have already begun in Jesus' name. Let's just pray right now. Lord, I thank you, God, for what you're doing, God. Thank you, Father, for the moving of your spirit in this sanctuary, God. Thank you, Lord, for emboldening us and empowering us, God, to share your gospel. Lord, I pray right now over those that have been mentioned, God, that you would give them healing. God, that you would bless them, that you would direct them, that you would lead them closer to you, that your perfect will would be done in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Give us the boldness, God, to start Bible studies, to continue them, Lord, for your name and for your sake, God. Lord God, help us to respond, Lord Jesus, when you call. Help us, oh God, when we're at the gas station, or when we're at the store, or when we're online, God. Help us to respond to the nudging of your spirit, God, to minister to somebody, God, that their soul could be saved. In Jesus' mighty name, I worship you, God. I worship you, Jesus. Yes, God, you're wonderful. You are worthy, Jesus. Thank you, Lord God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. What an honor it is to be used by God. We're going to touch so many souls this year. Hallelujah. We're going to continue worshiping. We're going to go into the offerings. There's multiple ways to give. It'll show up on our screen. But if we can all, as a sign of unity after the prayer, if we could all just come to the boxes and say the decree together in unity. Lord, I pray right now, Lord God, over the offering, Jesus, the gift and the giver. I pray, God, that you would bless it, that you would increase it into your kingdom. God, that you would give unto us what we need and bless your people in Jesus' mighty name. I worship you. Amen. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Say the decree with me if you're willing. Thou shalt also decree a thing, and it shall be established unto thee, and the light shall shine upon thy ways, upon the authority of your word I have given, and it shall be given unto me, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. I bring my tithe and offering into your storehouse. Therefore the enemy is rebuked, and the curse is broken. I live under an open heaven. You pour out upon me such a blessing that there is not enough room to receive it. We receive jobs, better jobs and promotions, raises and bonuses, sales and commissions, benefits and settlements, bills and debts paid off, estates and inheritances, interest and income. That's right, worship as you do it. Rebates and returns, checks in the mail, gifts and surprises, bills paid off, debts demolished and royalties received. My whole family saved and walking with God in abundant life, divine favor and blessing. Perfect health and abundance to walk in divine favor and blessing. I am blessed coming in. I am blessed going out. And all that I do will prosper in Jesus' name. Clap your hands unto the Lord. You may take your seats. You may take your seats. I just want to say to those that are new to the decree, what we are doing is we are speaking what God has already promised us to those that are faithful. We are decreeing what his word already says that is ours. We are just claiming it for ourselves in Jesus' name. Just a few announcements. Church prayer is moved to Friday the 27th at 7 p.m. And the youth rally is this Friday in Cape Coral. The van leaves here at 6 o'clock. So be here or be square. Praise the Lord. In Jesus' name.
Clap your hands one more time to Jesus. We love you, mighty God. We worship you, mighty God. Hallelujah. Yes, Van is going to the youth rally this coming Friday, 6 p.m. or shortly after. He'll leave from here. Talk to Pastor Daly. They will have food there, and he just asks you to put some kind of contribution in the offering plate, and he'll be happy. They won't be charging for the food afterwards. He also said they'll have some games and things afterwards at the young people will be doing. It's going to be a great time. So what a great time it is serving God. So encouraged this weekend, the services that was mentioned at the ministers' conference, for those in ministry positions and otherwise, and it was a special time. It really was. So I'm thankful for what he's doing. Can you pray with me? You can keep your seat. Can we pray together one more time? Lord Jesus, I thank you, mighty God, for your grace. Thank you for your mercy, God. Thank you for your healing virtue flowing in the lives of those that are sick, God. Thank you, God, for divine favor. Thank you for great revival. Thank you, Lord God, for anointing us to preach your anointed word. Father, work with us in Jesus' mighty name. Amen, amen, amen. Why don't you clap your hands and we welcome our guests in the back. It's great to be in the house of God with you. Somebody say, church. Talked to Pastor Sammy Coe last night late. Pastor's in LaBelle. He just got out of GO correctional facility, a prison, ministering to the inmates. And he said, I had church tonight. He said, sometimes the Spirit just moves and you have church. And God just moved and touched them and blessed them. And we emphasize church, come to church services. And here we have church services Wednesday night, 7 p.m., classes for the different ages. Sunday school, Sunday morning at 9:30, classes for all the ages. Our main morning worship service, Sunday morning, 11 a.m., and then our Sunday evening service at 6 p.m. And we emphasize church and coming to church. And you know, the thought perhaps is past your mind, why is that so important? It's just something else on my schedule. Why is it important that we gather in the house of God? Is it important you just come whenever you can, whenever it's convenient? Or should you try to be more diligent in your church attendance? Of course, things comes up for everybody. Sickness, you work late, we understand. But the question in my mind very early on in my walk with God was, why is church attendance so important? Remember in those early days, learning and gleaning things about church services, making observations. And I received the Holy Ghost. I was saved 19 years old. And as I'm making notes in my mind about church and what God does in church services and why church is so important, come to realize very quickly that I wasn't the only one making notes about church services and about church people. If you've been around church any time, you have heard kids and saw kids try to replicate the way that an elder saint of God or an adult saint of God shouts or prays or dances. I remember in those early days, we had some kids, I mean little bitty kids, and I'm not attacking anybody for their worship. I'm really not. But we had some little bitty kids, 4, 5, 6-year-old kids, that could shout just like brother whoever. John, that was 55 or 60, that had a funny little wiggle when he shouted, or could come in and, as my dear brother, Brother Stout, come in and lift up his hands, "Lord, bless this sanctuary." We love Brother Stout. God bless his memory. God bless his soul. God rest his soul. But children all over our church, including mine, came in, and not in a disrespectful way, but in a celebratory way, appreciating. They would replicate what the good elder done. "Lord, bless the sanctuary." But paying attention, what is church all about? Is it just coming for a few moments, a couple of times a week, to appease your conscience, to check the box and say, "I've been to church. Okay, I'm in good standing with God now because I've done my civic duty and attend the church"? Or is there something more to it than that? Let me offer you tonight a few observations I have made along the way about church services. First, I direct you in a Bible study tonight. You can remain seated. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 1 and verse 2. It speaks right to this day and hour we're living in. I'll start out with this theme and I'll finish with it in a few moments. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 1 and verse 2. He says, "Now we beseech you, brethren, by the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, and by our gathering together unto him, that you be not soon shaken in mind, or be troubled, neither by spirit of man," lowercase s, "or demonic spirit, nor by word, nor by letter, as from us, as that the day of Christ is at hand." So he paints a pretty serious warning that you be not troubled, that you don't allow a spirit to trouble you. You don't allow a word to trouble you. At this time, there were some false letters that were being circulated. And they tried to say and present that Paul wrote the epistle or letter, and he did not. And he says that you would not be shaken by those things. But then the two things that he leans into in verse 1 that will help the good saints of God to not be shaken, somebody say not shaken, is in verse 1 of 2 Thessalonians 2, he says, "Now we beseech you, brethren, by the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ." That's the first thing. You have to be ever mindful that Jesus is coming. You have to be ever cognitive that he could come at a moment's notice. The Lord's imminent return. Uncertain timing of his return. And then he goes on the latter part of verse 1. "And by our gathering together unto him." That's one of those ingredients that helps us to not be shaken by spirits. That helps us to not be shaken by the words of some, that helps us to not be overwhelmed in our faith. Whenever we read something a letter that's negative. A new story is first, we are looking to Jesus' return. And second, I'm part of a church that believes in the Word of God. And as we gather together, I get strength. I begin to sense and feel what God is doing. And that helps me. Can I have an amen? Clap your hands to Jesus. What are my observations about church and church services? Romans chapter 10, verse 14 and verse 17. Romans chapter 10, verse 14 and verse 17. Familiar passage. I don't know exactly when I begin to comprehend what this verse means, but it is absolutely life-changing when you get it, when you understand it. Romans 10, verse 14, we'll jump down to 17. It says in Romans 10, 14, how then shall they call upon him in whom they have not believed? How shall they believe in him whom they have not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? Somebody say a preacher. Verse 17, this is the verse. So then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. When Brother Kleindienst finished that wonderful message that he preached Friday night at the meeting that different ones was talking about, how we survived the furnace, were able to survive the heat of the demonic attacks that we are feeling in this day, in this hour. When it was over, he was being thronged with people. I sent him a text late that night and said, thank God for the preacher, somebody that heard from God, that preached the word of God with clarity, with revelation, with fierce boldness, and with grace and with mercy. Thank God for the preacher. Can I have an amen? But it is in a church service that God uses preachers, men and women, prophets, prophetess, teachers. God uses them. But it's not just coming for a lecture. It's not just coming to hear 3 points a poem and go home. But you understand what happens as we gather together and we listen to the Word of God under the anointing of God by somebody that is called by God to preach it and to declare it. When we hear the Word of God, there is a transmission that takes place. You're not with me. There is a releasing of spiritual virtue and spiritual power that flows not out of an individual, but it flows out of the Word of God, and it is distributed by the Spirit of God. As the Word of God is spoken, revelation is released. Impartation of strength is released. You come in discouraged, and you hear the Word of God, and you leave invigorated. You come in with questions and wonders. You leave being fully persuaded that God is able to do what he said he would do. Clap your hands to the Lord. So then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. We can slice verse 17 a number of ways, I agree. You can get faith in God through study of the word, amen. Through reading your Bible, amen, and we should. Through listening to the Bible. Through going back and studying notes from church services, all that's good. But in the context of it, it is tied to the word of God that's coming through a preacher. It is tied to verse 14. It is tied to, in the text, the word of God that is preached through a preacher. It's not a preacher's words. It's not the glorified flesh. That man, that woman, that preacher is not to glorify flesh. But it is to recognize that God does something when we come together in a house of God, in a gathering as a congregation, and we listen to preaching. We listen to the word of God. It is the power that pulls from the pit and draws men and women unto God. There are supernatural things that are done at the authority of preaching. we've all been in church services before when they read a familiar text. Most all have been in church services before when they read a familiar text and you say, oh man, as they preaching from Acts 2:38, as they preaching from John 3:16, as they preaching from Genesis chapter 1, verse 1, I've heard that verse a million times. But then before it's over, you're scratching your head as I'm scratching my head and saying, my God, there's so much more in there than I've never even seen. There's so many more revelations in there. And God just uses preaching in just another regular Sunday night church service, in just another Wednesday night gathering, Sunday morning service. God just uses preaching to transmit faith, to release revelation, and to speak very pointedly and very specifically the things in your life that you've not told anybody about. That's another observation I've made about what God does in our church services. Can I have an amen? Clap your hands to the Lord. Yeah. Observations about our church services. 31 years now serving God. Psalms chapter 23, verse 6. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. It seems to be a connection together between being committed to dwelling in the house of the Lord. And let me just pause and say, it's not exclusively about brick and mortar. More than that, it is about being in covenant relationship with God. And yes, God honors the facility not because of the brick and the mortar, but because it becomes holy ground as we gather together and God's presence is here and God's word is here and God's name is declared here. And then it's no longer just brick and mortar, but it's a dwelling place for God. It's a dwelling house for the Lord. And the psalmist says, I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. And give me a little latitude here. And thus, goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. He joins them together with this three-letter word, this conjunction in, as to say neither statement stands alone. Dwelling in God's house is tied to goodness and mercy following me all the days of my life. I'm a better man because I serve Jesus Christ. And I choose to be part of a congregation and gather with like-minded believers. Thank you, Sister Pierre. Like-minded believers and worship together. It's not that I trust in the brick and the mortar, but God does something in me. God impacts me. He adds layer upon layer to my life, seasoning the deepening work of the Spirit, the maturing of God in my life. It just seems like the more I'm in church, the more I experience the goodness of God. The more I gather with like-minded believers, the more I experience the mercy of God. The more I come to the house of God and worship, the more I'm overtaken by the presence of God. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me as long as I'm in the house of God, dwelling in God's house. Another observation about what God gives us, what he imparts and releases into our life as we come together for just another church service. Another revelation. Psalms 96 and verse 6. Strength and beauty in his sanctuary. I'm with you. It's been said. Just driving up at the house of God. Just I've had countless people tell me, just walking in through the doors, I feel the presence of God. I've had visitors that have no mind or understanding of the amount of prayers that you pray in this building. People that have no concept of what's been done in this building to welcome God's presence and God's Spirit. They'll tell me, first-time guests, when I pulled onto the parking lot, I felt something. I felt God. When I walked in, I began to feel the touch of God from the first moment in the doors. I begin to feel it. It's not because we're special or you're special, but it's the presence of God, and His presence dwells in His sanctuary. The Bible says, Psalms 96:6, again, there is strength and beauty in His sanctuary. He beautifies us with His salvation. He beautifies the saints of God with His salvation. I can feel at times just coming into the house of God. Sometimes I'm here by myself, just here praying, and the illumination of God's Spirit's upon me. I pray at my house. Probably not as much as I should, but I pray a lot at my house. I pray other places. I have some visitations from God in my automobile, pull off on the side of the road. But it's just something different about praying in the house of God, in the sanctuary. I had somebody ask me recently, Pastor, is it okay if I go up to church? And individual had a church key. They had the code. Individual asked me, is it okay if I just go up to church at 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning and just spend some time praying and talking to God? I said, is it okay? Can I put that on a billboard out there by the road that you'll be up there praying? Perhaps somebody else would like to come. Absolutely, it's okay. I know we can pray at the house. I know God is omnipresent, but there's something that takes place when we come into His sanctuary. I just find a level of divine strength sovereign from God as I come into the sanctuary. There is a touch of God here. There's an anointing of God here. The river of God in Scripture is seen flowing out of the house of God. I'm excited when I can come to the head of the river and experience it fresh and get the strength afresh and get the touch of God afresh. In the sanctuary is beauty. In the sanctuary is strength. He doesn't say in the courtyard. He didn't say in the outer part of the building. Those are biblical words. He says something's different in the sanctuary, where the prayers are prayed, where the offerings of sacrifice and praise and worship go forth, where the word of God is declared in the holy place. It's different in the sanctuary. It's not the lesson what God does in your life away from this building, but it's different in the sanctuary. Psalms chapter 22. Verse 3. I'm among some people tonight that have had some genuine encounters with God alone. And truly, some of your greatest encounters with God will come alone. You need to have a prayer closet or a place of prayer, if it's your lanai by your pool, out under your oak tree, whatever that is. You need to have a place where you can pray alone and talk to God. If you don't have that, if you just rely upon church services, you are in trouble. You're probably barely treading water as a Christian if you're even doing that. You got to have a private place of prayer. Can I have an amen? If Jesus had a solitary place of prayer, if He had a time in which He came down and walked with Adam in the cool of the day, it seems like to me we ought to have a time and we ought to have a place of solitary prayer where we turn off the phone, turn off the noise, and just listen to Jesus and pour it all out when nobody's watching. And you just spend some time with the King, not because of self-aggrandizement, not because of somebody's accolade or acknowledgement, but because you want to talk to the King, because you want to pray and be intimate with Jesus Christ. As much as I believe all of that is significant, as important as all that is, there's something that happens when we gather together in His name. Two or three are gathering in His name. He is there in the midst. Psalms 22:3. God dwells in the midst of the praises of His people. God dwells, but thou art holy, O thou that inhabitest the praises of Israel. You go back and you dig this word out, inhabitest the praises of Israel. Israel can also, in this verse, be applied to the people of God in the New Testament. There's the church. There's many verses that would tie this truth to also the church. But this word inhabitus, it means literally God enthrones himself around. God literally enthrones himself in the midst of praise. Whenever you begin to praise and worship God as a collective corporate body, as much as God can do for you individually, it exponentially increases. One could chase 1,000, two could put 10,000 to flight. Yes, you can get a hold of God on your own, but there's something that happens in a church service when like-minded believers that call upon the name of Jesus and have the force, the greatest force in this world, faith releasing the Spirit of God in prayer. When believers come together, singleness of mind, on one accord, and begin to lift up their voice in prayer, God comes down and inhabits that. He dwells in the midst of that. Hallelujah. Clap your hands. He dwells, he inhabits the praises of his people. He is drawn to that. Have you ever been in a church service? And it's good. It's good to be there. You appreciate the songs and the music. Everything's good. But it's not glorious. It's good, but it's not glorious. And somewhere in the midst of, I can't altogether explain it, but I can recognize it. Somewhere in the midst of the first song, second song, something shifts. And the Spirit of God just sets down. And you can feel it. The weightiness, the train of the Lord just fills the house. The glory of God just begins to sit down and hover down as his people come together and begin to praise him and worship him. And you've just come into the presence of God. You have just invited God's Spirit down into your arena, and you have just elevated your mind and your emotions above your problem, above your circumstances, and you've come into his arena. Can I have an amen? It is also seen in Matthew 18 and 20, the significance of this observation about church services. Matthew 18 and 20, where two or three are gathered together in my name, I am there in the midst. God comes down. If you're having a problem with something, get to a church service. If you can't pray past something, get to a church service. Ask somebody to bind together, touch and agree upon earth, it shall be so in the heavens. If you've been praying and fasting, I feel this in the Holy Ghost right now. You've been praying and fasting, and you've not got past that problem. You need to get a brother to agree with you, or get a sister, ladies, to agree with you, and then come together in agreement, two or three, in the name of Jesus, in a church service, and in the sanctuary of strength, and pray together with greater authority until something breaks, until something shifts, until God shows up and does something. Two or three gather together in my name, and they're in the midst. It's a fascinating verse. I wonder why he chose two or three. I wonder why he puts it like that. Two or three. Less or more. Two or three. The smaller number, the bigger number. Seems like to me what he is saying, beyond the significance of witness, beyond the significance of having somebody to come together and agree with you and extend their faith and your faith, beyond even that, I think what he is saying is on a smaller service, a lower attended service, I can still move. If there's a lesser number there, two, I can show up and move. If there's a greater number there, three, packed house, I can show up and move. I'm not limited if the house is full, God is saying. And I'm not limited if it's only a few folks on a Sunday night. That's okay. I just need somebody in the earth to give me a witness. I need somebody in a church service to say, God, I still believe. I'm trusting for a miracle. I've showed up to get something. I've showed up for a word. I come to get a touch of God. Two or three. Hallelujah. Clap your hands one more time to the Lord. My observations about church services. Another, Proverbs 27 and 17. We experience this here today. Wasn't the testimonies great? Isn't it great? John declares under inspiration of God that we overcome by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of our testimony. Seemed like to me if you asked a question, okay, good scholar, can you give me a list of things in the Bible on what we use to overcome? That's a pretty long list. I'm like thinking of a lot of things. But in Revelation, he only listed two. We overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. Of course, there's other things, prayer, fasting, all of that. But in that illustration, he only listed two. Blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. Wow. The blood of the Lamb, I get that one. If there's a list of two things that we use to overcome, I get the blood because it's tied to Calvary and it's like the most significant of all moments in Scripture. I get the blood. But then your testimony, that's like not even in my top 20. It's like way down here. And he puts it side by side with the blood. He puts it side by side with the blood. There's something that happens when you open your mouth up, when you begin to speak. Do you know that the energy that is released through sound never dies? It is constant motion in the universe. It never dies. The energy that is released when you open your mouth up and you begin to speak. Go back and study it out. Keep the preacher honest. When you open your mouth up and you begin to speak, sound waves do not die. They just go, they become energy ultimately is what happens to them. And it just goes on and on and on. I don't necessarily like that word energy, but it's what the scientists say. But when you open up your mouth, it does something in the spirit. Have you ever studied how many different times in Scripture the significance of the shout is seen? And what takes place when you begin to shout? A Shabbat shout was seen in the Old Testament multiple times. Like when Joshua and the children of God began to march around Jericho, and then the seventh day, seven times, and they shouted. That's a Shabbat shout. It is an overcoming shout. It literally pierces the atmosphere. It recalibrates how they measure different things. They measure the volume of the noise. And they determine what it does based upon how loud it is. A Shabbat shout, a Shabbat praise recalibrates the spirit atmosphere. You want God to show up and do something in your life? You get to testifying in a church service. You begin to open your mouth up in the presence of witnesses with all of heaven watching and all of hell listening. And you open your mouth up and say, I'm believing God for new Bible studies. I believe in God to go higher. I believe in God for a miracle. Open your mouth up in a church service and testify. I wonder, maybe seated. I wonder somehow if that's tied to what it says in Revelations. Someone's off in the heavens. If the prayers of the saints of God are stored up in vials, if they just stay alive, they never die. Those words, the prayers of the saints, they just never die. Someone's out there in the great beyond. I don't understand all of it, but someone's out there in the great beyond. I got a whole lot of declarations of praise just flying around out there. I got a whole lot of testimonies that have never died. They've been fulfilled, many of them. I have a whole lot of prayers. Many's been answered. But there's a whole lot of spoken prayers in church services that are giving the devil a headache out in the spirit world because they never die. Sound that never dies. So when we gather in church services, we open up our mouth to speak. Not just in the pulpit, not just singing a song, but when you give a testimony. Iron sharpeneth iron. So a man sharpeneth the countenance of his friend. You need not just to hear the preacher in the pulpit say God is able. But you need to hear your brother in the parking lot say. You need to hear your sister out here say it's going to work out. God's going to get you through this. You need your friend to come up alongside you and pray. Faith and hope and trust and confidence into your soul. Those are some things that I've observed as utterly key and critically important in my 31 years in serving God. I hasten. Psalm 68 in verse 6. The Bible says that God setteth the solitary in family. God sets solid people, strong people in the families. God puts people that have been islands and self-sustaining, self-sufficient. God brings them and puts them in the families. You're not alone now. You're strong. You could be an island. You could be out there by yourself, solitary by yourself. But I want you to be part of something big. You can pray by yourself, but I want you to be part of something big. You can read your Bible by yourself, you can. But I need you to be part of something bigger. I bring you into my family. You ever studied about in the New Testament how many times the people of God are described as a family of God? The congregation of God, the sons and daughters of God, the offspring of God. Why they call each other brother and sister, why they greet each other as brethren. It's not just there for filling up pages on a word, filling up a page with words, but it is there so that we understand the concept of family. And God will take that, I mean, no disrespect, God will take that strong Lone Ranger believer and set them the solitary in family. Because really nobody can be a good, strong Christian believer alone. The hand, as Paul writes, is dependent upon the arm. We are fitly joined together in the body of Christ. And God puts into his body those people as it pleaseth him. I'm so thankful I don't have to carry the responsibility of who's in and who's out. But he puts into his body as it pleaseth him. We need each other. We need the uniqueness of each other. We need the unique way like those kids do. We need that guy worshiping like that and that woman worshiping like that. And I'm thankful for the strong, bold, somewhat louder personality of that individual. Thank God for it. I'm also thankful for the quiet, sheepish, faint-hearted prayer that this lady prays that is equally moving and arresting of God, just like that loud, bombastic prayer that man plays. We need each other. We are dependent. Now, I've seen that more than ever in collective church services. I see a picture of the family of God and all the uniqueness and variety, ups and downs, and even all the mess that your family has. I've seen all that in God's great congregation as we gather together. And frankly speaking, it's exactly the way the Bible paints a picture. Read about the church in Corinth. Read about the church in Galatia, the church in Thessalonica, the church in Ephesus. The families get along. We benefit from the good of each other, and we just keep loving each other through the other stuff. We just keep looking past it. We know that greater things are ahead. Iron sharpeneth iron. God said it, the strong, those that alone and isolated, the solitary in families. Thank you, Brother Zachary, for coming. Isaiah 37, verse 1, time of great national crisis. Hezekiah finds refuge in God's house. It's been one of the key points for me about church. Hezekiah found refuge in the house of God. I remember several years ago, I didn't get it then, I do understand it now. I didn't throw a stone at the man then, and I certainly would not now. But I was a young believer, 21, 22 years old, and there was a man that worked 12-hour shifts at the International Paper Mill in our hometown. And he worked several of them, then he would have 3 days off, work several more, 3 days off, and took care of a big family, God bless them. But he was always exhausted when he was able to come to church. And I like Pentecostal churches. And I was raised up in an all-African-American Pentecostal church. It's another level. I mean, the music is off the chain, and it's loud and high energy. I mean, no disrespect. I got saved in that church. But I'm looking at this guy, and he's back there sleeping. I mean, his head is laid back on the pew, and it's not just a dozing off a little bit. I mean, he's going at it. He's up into the third heaven. I mean, no disrespect. He's up into the third heaven. He's dreaming, baby. It's not about Jesus. And it's like almost every service he comes. Brother Ellis, almost every service he comes, he's doing that. I'm a brand new convert. I didn't know how to spell Bible, so I didn't do anything. But I'm thinking, maybe I need to go and wake him up, like he's embarrassing his family and disrespectful to the house of God, whatever. I didn't know anything. Just a dumb 20, 21-year-old kid. But I asked him one day about it. We was having a men's luncheon, throwing horseshoes. And I said, I noticed you come to church, and I know you love God, and you live this way, and you embrace the Bible, like you sleep a lot in church. I said, I don't get that. I'm like afraid if I fall asleep in church, a lightning bolt's going to hit me. Now, I didn't have a job working 12 hours a day in the plant, neither. He said, you know what it is, Daniel. He said, my life is so hurt, and I'm pressurized so much at work. I'm pressurized so much at home. Bills, responsibility, a lot of kids. And he was an excellent husband and father, excellent. But he says, when I walk in the house of God, I have such a flood of emotions. But more than anything else, it's a refuge for me. My soul is at rest more than any other place when I'm in church. I feel such a peace. And he says, and you watch me. I don't just walk in and lay down and go to sleep. He says, I try to worship, and then my soul just... The house of God is a great refuge. Remember, Sister Dagan, many years ago, my wife, been here now 20 years, started the church out here about 20 years ago, and one of the first things God showed my wife about us coming to this area and starting the church was in one of the beach areas right here on the coast. She was walking down the middle of the road going towards the beach, and we had never seen the road. We've since seen it. We've seen it 6 months after we were down here. But she was walking down the road, and as she's walking down the road, there was people with like open wounds and cuts and bad scars that had healed. Very deep scars that had healed that was coming out of the buildings on both sides of the road and coming to her and beginning to walk behind her. And she was in a prayerful spirit walking down the road in the dream and asking God to just heal with the touch of the Spirit and the balm of Gilead. And we felt like in that very early vision that God was going to use our ministry here to be an oasis, to be a refuge. I thought about it. I haven't done it yet. We might do it yet. I've not felt released to do it yet. But we might do it at some point yet. But very early after God gave my wife that vision, I thought about putting a billboard up on 75 and saying, in a vacation state, we offer the God of rest and a place of refuge. I've been amazed at how many people have been hurt in churches. by preachers and Christians in this area. And they just need a place of refuge. Remember, Brother Jones, I'm closing right now. Remember, Brother Jones, one of our first snowbirds. Northern friends, they live in the trailer park right off of 776 in Inglewood. Neighbors with Brother and Sister Speakman. And Rose Jones and Brother Jones came. You were there, Brother Gerald. I don't know if you remember, but you were there in the storefront in Inglewood. And he had been a Pentecostal apostolic pastor. Things happened, got devastated, hurt, kicked to the curb. And he was suffering deep, deep spiritual, emotional trauma. And he came into a little broke-down storefront church. He says, man, I just feel a refreshing healing here. My wife sang Amazing Grace with a broken-down snare drum and about a two-string guitar. Some brother just got the Holy Ghost a few weeks earlier, was playing it. She sang Amazing Grace, and I can remember still to this day, from the pulpit in that little storefront church in the back right corner. Brother Jones, Zachary said it. He was a little boy then. Caught the Holy Ghost and had a Holy Ghost fit. And God renewed him in the Holy Ghost. And in the house of God, a little storefront, in the house of God, he felt the love of God. And God covered him in his refuge. God covered him with his mercy and his love one more time. I guess as much as anything, let this be a saving station. But right there next to that and behind that, I pray, let this be a place, a refuge for the hurting. The outcast, the backslider, Alex said it to me this afternoon. He said something to me that he had said to somebody at school, a kid. What he had said was, we stand against sin, but we love the sinner. I said, that's right, Alex. He didn't say it just like that, but that's what he said. Whatever they've done, we got a refuge for them. Come on in. There's something that happens in a holy house when hurting people come in. Help us to never cast a stone at them. I don't care what they've done. God forbid that would be your son or your daughter. God forbid. If it wasn't for the grace of God, there I would go. There I would go. Can you stand with me? 2 Chronicles chapter 20, verse 9. We stand before this house in thy presence, for thy name is in this house, and we cry unto thee in our affliction. And then thou wilt hear and help us. Same passage. In this house is God's presence, and his name is declared in this place. And in this place, we cry. I've cried some prayers in here. I would be absolutely mortified if you ever heard them. I've prayed some prayers in here. I would absolutely feel undone and overwhelmed if anybody else ever heard them. I've shed some tears in this place that I wouldn't tell anybody. And we've cried unto thee in our affliction in the house of God. And you helped us. Verse 12. We have no might against our enemy, and we don't know what to do, but in this house our eyes are upon thee. I don't know how many times I've drug my lazy, dead, defeated, discouraged, doubt-laden soul into a house of God. And in that house of God, I said, Lord, I have no might, and I don't know what to do. But I've made it to your house, and I need you to meet me here. I've come together. Paul says, as you see the day of the Lord approaching, gather even the more. When you're facing your darkest moments, you cannot stay home. I understand people get sick, please. I understand you may have to work. I know that. But don't let discouragement keep you at home, okay? Don't let doubt or a trial keep you at home. I wonder if we can just close our eyes tonight, however you want to respond, but I think it would be fitting and appropriate to thank God for this house. I don't want to take this place for granted. I don't want to take for granted that God's presence dwells here, that we have a nice, comfortable, blessed place to come to. It's not the brick and the mortar, but it's the presence of God that's here. It's the name of God that's here. It's the people that gather here in His name. It's the prayers that's prayed here. It's a biblical truth that's tied to this building, this place of gathering. I think it would be great tonight if we just take a few minutes and begin to thank Him for this house. When was the last time you thanked God for a church building to come to? When was the last time you thanked God for a place of gathering to come together? Altars to pray at, a place to sing and worship, a place where you can testify. I don't want to take one church service for granted. I don't want to take one gathering for granted. God, I thank you for your church, your congregation of people. I know the church is not a building, but I'm thankful tonight, God, for this building, for this place of gathering, oh God. That's it all over this house. Can you begin to pray?
Thank you, Lord Jesus, so much, God, for this house. Thank you, God, for a multitude of counselors, Lord God. I thank you so much, Lord Jesus, for what you have done already, God, and what you plan to do in this place, God, in our lives, Jesus. God, I pray that you help us, Lord, to fight hell to get here. I pray, God, that you help us, Lord, to die daily to get here. Whatever is in the way of us getting to this house, whether it be something on our schedule, God, help us to lay it down so that we can get to a place of refreshing, so we can get to the place of strength and renewing, God, so that we can make it to heaven, God. Though hell comes against us and every soldier therein, help us, God, to have a devotion to you. Help us, God, have a passion for you, oh God, that supersedes any other thing, Jesus. In the name of Jesus, God, I worship you. Lord, I magnify you, God, and I thank you, Jesus. Father, I'm praying right now, God, that you would help us, Jesus. Help us, oh God, strengthen us, Lord, in this place, God. Help us, Lord, to have the revelation of the power of the house of God and fellowship here, God. In Jesus' mighty name, in the name of Jesus, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, I pray, God, I worship you. I worship you, Jesus. God, give your people strength, God. Help them, Lord, to resist the lies of Satan, God. Help them, Lord Jesus, to develop a love for truth, God. Grow them in the things of God. In Jesus' mighty name I pray, and I worship you, and I thank you, God, and I love you, Jesus. You are worthy, Lord. You are worthy, Jesus. Hey, Rabbi Yeshua.